The three-dimensional rectangular coordinate system, also known as the Cartesian coordinate system, is made of three number lines that are concurrent, meaning that they intercept each other at the origin, and also perpendicular to each other. These three number lines, known as the x, y, z axis, divide the space into eight octants, as demonstrated by the eight cubes with different colors in this image. The reason why this is called a right-handed coordinate system is because the positive directions of the three axes follow the right-hand rule. Which means that if you roll the four fingers in your right hand from the positive x direction towards the positive y direction, as shown in this image, then your thumb will point towards the positive z direction. So if we transfer an arbitrary vector a into an established Cartesian coordinate system with the tail of the vector fall on the origin, then we can first apply the parallelogram law to resolve vector a into two component vectors, az that falls along the z-axis and a prime that falls within the xy plane. Then we can apply the parallelogram law again to resolve vector a prime into the two components, ax along the x-axis and ay along the y-axis. We can prove that a equals to ax plus ay plus az, and therefore ax, ay, and az are the three rectangular components of vector a. Since a vector needs to be described by two parts, its magnitude and its direction, we can separate these two parts by defining unit vectors. For any arbitrary vector a, its unit vector ua has the same direction but a magnitude of unit length 1. Therefore, vector a can be expressed by its magnitude a, which is a scalar, multiplied by its unit vector ua. As mentioned earlier, a unit vector can be defined for any arbitrary vector a. However, there are three special unit vectors, I, j, and k, which, as you can tell, have their own names. They are special because they are designated to the directions of x, y, and z axis, respectively, in the Cartesian coordinate system. Therefore, using the unit vectors I, j, and k, the component vectors along the x, y, and z axis can now be written as axi, ayj, and azk, with ax, ay, and az being the magnitudes of the component vectors. When a vector is expressed this way, we call it a Cartesian vector. And by applying the Pythagorean theorem twice, we can derive that the magnitude of the vector a equals to the square root of ax squared plus ay squared plus az squared. To describe the direction of the vector, we can use the coordinate direction angles alpha, beta, and gamma. Alpha is defined as the angle between the vector and x-axis, and similarly, beta and gamma are angles between the vector and the y and z-axis, respectively. If we highlight the plane made by the vector a and the x-axis, shown as the blue shaded area, then according to trigonometry, we know that cosine alpha equals to ax divided by a. Similarly, as shown in the right triangle made by the vector and the y-axis, cosine beta also equals to ay divided by a. And again, cosine gamma also equals to az divided by a. And then, because the unit vector of vector a, ua, equals to vector a divided by its magnitude, ua can be derived as ax over a times I plus ay over a times j plus az over a times z. Or ua equals to cosine alpha I plus cosine beta j and plus cosine gamma k. And since the magnitude of unit vector is always 1, therefore we can come to the conclusion that the sum of the cosine squared of the three coordinate direction angles for any Cartesian vector must equal to 1. Therefore, when you perform Cartesian vector addition or subtraction, All you need to do is to sum the I, j, and k components of the vectors up separately, and those will become the new I, j, and k components of the resultant vector. Let's look at this example. We are given a force vector in Cartesian vector form, and we need to determine its magnitude, its unit vector, as well as the three coordinate direction angles, alpha, beta, and gamma. Let's look at the magnitude first. The magnitude of any Cartesian vector simply equals to the square root of the sum of the squares of each component. Therefore, from here, we can easily calculate the magnitude to be 4.2 kilonewton. And then to determine the unit vector of any vector equals to the vector divided by its magnitude. And as you can see, the unit kilonewton gets canceled out, and the unit vector UF is a dimensionless quantity. You can simplify it if you want to. And then lastly, for the direction angles, remember the x, y, and z components of the unit vector are the cosine values of the three angles alpha, beta, and gamma. Therefore, angle alpha, which is the angle made by the vector with the positive direction of the x-axis, equals to the inverse cosine or arc cosine 2 over 7 to be 73.4 degree. And similarly, beta equals to arc cosine the y component of the unit vector, negative 3 over 7, and also gamma equals to arc cosine 6 over 7. And now we calculated the magnitude, unit vector, and the direction angles, and that answers this question. In this example, a force with the magnitude of 1,200 newton is shown in the XYZ coordinate system. And we are also given two of its direction angles. Angle alpha is 60 degree and beta is 45 degree. We need to express this force in Cartesian vector form and also determine its unit vector. Since we know that for any Cartesian vector, its three direction angles, alpha, beta, and gamma, are related by this equation. Therefore, we can try to solve for gamma. Cosine gamma squared equals to 0.25. And cosine gamma has two possible values, positive or negative 0.5, which means that gamma can be either 60 degree or 120 degree. Now let's look at the image. As you can see, the force falls in the octant made by the positive x, positive y, and negative part of the z-axis. And also we know that the direction angle is defined as the angle made by the force with the positive part of the axis. Therefore, this angle gamma is 120 degree. From here, we can determine its unit vector by plugging in the values of cosine alpha, beta, and gamma. And then we can determine the Cartesian form of this force vector by multiplying its magnitude to its unit vector. As you can see, the unit vector is dimensionless, but the force vector does have the unit of newton, and this answers the problem.